Turing. Okay, he is a great man. Like if you are in physics course, what is the respect of Albert Einstein? Same is Alan Turing. Anybody can have any, who has, what is the basic work of Alan Turing? In fact, he is the basic inventor of the computer science. There are other great peoples are there. Okay, coming back to the question, some of you have got question, good question. One question is asked, which language to start in competitive programming, say either C or Java. One student have asked the question, very good question. The question is that it depends on the application. See, it's typical nowadays, whatever your application, like data processing application, okay, your C, Java is okay. But typical new types of application like machine learning, some of you have already mentioned. What is machine learning is? Machine learning is you already have a huge number of data. Like right now, you are making Facebook friends, you have lots of like, dislike, you have Instagram and you have WhatsApp data. You are generating data. In fact, you are clicking your name, roll number, and you are generating this data. From this kind of data, there's a labeled choices that whether you like coffee, whether you like tea, whether which kind of coffee and all these things. You have already lots of huge data is there. So from this data, can we generate a choice? So you have all, can you generate a program? That is the thing. We are till now in the next semester, you will be learned how to program it. Okay, your computer is nothing but garbage in and garbage out. You need certain data, otherwise you cannot produce output. So you garbage in and garbage out. In between, the computer is there. What is the computer? There is some program is running, and the program is running basics on some algorithm. So that's it. So now program runs on a computer with an operating system and running. When the program is running, then we call it not a program, we call it a process. That I have covered in my last video. Okay. Right now, the one question is whether to learn C, Java and Python. So traditional applications, maybe C, C++, Java is okay. But more emerging platform is coming from like machine learning, where the machine is automatically programmed itself. Okay. With the lots of data is already there. Earlier, 30 years back, there is hardly any data, but right now you have lots of data are there, whether a particular brain tumor is malignant or non-malignant, breast cancer is malignant or non-malignant with the images. Now, images is also there, what type of malignancy from grade 0 to 9 are there. So, if you have a lots of, if you have 30,000 images or 1 lakh images, then from that images, if you unknown image, I can learn it quickly, even the better than the doctor. So that's a great point of it. So that is the machine learning programming. This kind of machine learning programming, C is not well suited, Java is not well suited, C++ is not well suited. There the Python is the choice. So there's a different of environment. In generally Python, you can do lots of any types of programming. You can make a program which runs on a console, which kind of program runs on a web. That's a great thing. With Java, we have any type of program you can run on a console, internet. We see we can write any type of program on console, but it cannot write, the program cannot be run at the internet. So that's it. So C is a kind of a assembly language. Very, you have to run, you have to write a lot of code, but C++ is excellent language. You have to learn C well. Now you have to ask why you have chosen Python, because it is not the next semester requirement. That is a great thing, because whatever the thing in the next semester, the data structure, this is needless, because your teachers are there. I might be there in C lab. I may be there or might not be there. That is not issue. But I think something new should be there, so that whenever third semester, you have a Python lab. So then this 2 days of effort, of our effort, will come to fruition, I believe. So that is the reason I have chosen to Python, and the computer science is a whole big subject, so everything cannot be covered. So basically my objective is to learn Python as quickly as possible, and some MCQ questions will be there tomorrow or day after tomorrow, and again on the Sundays and Mondays covering the courses. And you have to do a small mini project in Python coding that will be evaluated in the next week. So you will be given 1 week time. So these 2 days, Tuesdays and Saturdays, I try to cover as much as Python. If you want, I can cover a little bit of machine learning also. Then it will be given back to you. You take one more week and do a mini project on Python. That's it. That is the first of it. So there is no conflict of learning C and Python. C is a basic language. It's like a, but it is also true that you don't have, you have to master C, then you can understand Python. That's not true. So it is totally interdependent, not interdependent. So you can learn Python first and you can learn C later. That's all. So but right now the C is your next semester. It is better you can start C right now. And Python, what easier to write, so you get the essence of love of computer science from writing Python. Any more question, I can get it. And another question Rohit has asked in section B, he questions operator complexity, the complexity of algorithm. Algorithm basically, I have covered in my last video. Please see that last video. The algorithm is the basically trick. Okay, so algorithm is a trick, and that you have to write it in English-like languages. And the complexity, O1 complexity I have covered, that is push and pop. That is, there's another great gentleman, that is Donald Knuth. Other than whatever I've covered, Alan Turing, you must see, there's a movie is there, the of Alan Turing. That movie you must see, about the German machine, that code breaker. That is one movie is Code Breaker, Imitation Game. It's a good movies. There's an Oscar winning movies you must see to learn about the Alan Turing biography. Donald Knuth, one of this. So this is called data structure. Basically, data structure is you algorithm, you know, steps. Now algorithms to work it in a real environment, you have to run in a program, in a computer. In computer, the first takes control of operating system, and operating system which always runs, and there you have to learn the program should be written in some programming language, either C, or it can be C++ or in Java. Is how put your data, because it's the garbage in and garbage out. What the program does, the garbage in, how you put your data. That is, if you put your data in different bucket and different sort of way, that is the built-in data structure of a programming languages. So generally C does have like integer, float, character and pointer. This is typical C. But whenever you go for Python, Python gives you advantage, like it creates a list. A list means it can have a list. A list can, it is not like an array. List is, it can have an integer, then it can have a floating point number, or it can have some string, or it can have anything. So that is the advantage. It's a mixed type. It is arrays in C array. It is all should be of same type. It is not like list can be linear list like stack or queues, or whether it's a tree and graphs. As a file. So these are the typical data structure. It is there. And this is, I talk about the algorithm. What are the types of algorithm? First algorithm is the brute force algorithm. Remember that famous saying, to find a haystack, you find a needle in a haystack. So you have to, every haystack you have to find a needle. But you, if you have a clever trick, like if you use like, this is a brute force algorithm. This is, we generally follow every day. And if you create, if you have a bad net, you can get a needle out of it very quickly. That this, you can call, this is the concept of algorithm. Algorithm means it should be faster, quicker, and it should not be brute force. So brute force is a basic default case. Like I have given example of selection sort. And this is the, you have to have a more cleverer technique. So day by day, we are generating this type of clever techniques, this algorithm. So brute force, you just have some idea. Every PPT will be shared, don't worry. So let's quickly go through. These are the techniques that brute force I have to divide and conquer. In my earlier video, I have already covered like March sort. Say if you have a 120 numbers of data, 128 number of data, if you give a selection sort to sort it, it first select the minimum, then put it in the first place. Then 127 data, it takes the second minimum, put it to the second place. And 126 data takes the minimum, put it to third place. This is the stupidest language. This is brute force. Even if the almost sorted data, it will take that amount of time. The because it is compare every element with every element number of times, n number, so that is the complexity is n square. Okay, this is n square algorithm. But if you say divide and conquer, I put 128 to divide by 64, divided again by 32, again by 16, again by 8, again by 4, again by 2, then I sort amongst these two elements and merge it again. So this is divide and conquer, then typical time is n log n. N log n is a huge improvement of n square if n is huge. So if it's n is 16, that doesn't matter. And n, if it's n is 1024 or 2048, this is a huge improvement. So there's a different types of algorithm, you know, and this is constant, like push and pop O n. This is O log n. Please make your mic off. This O log n. O log n is a binary search. Say if your datas are in a binary search tree, to find the minimum or maximum, it will be a logarithm, O log n. Okay. Visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank
yes,
you. Sir. Thank you. Great. Okay. This is the gentleman named Alan Turing. He is father of computer science, like Albert Einstein or figure to physics. He is there. There is two famous films. One is Imitation Game, and that film you should see. It's all available on internet. That is the best biography. There are other biographies also there. That is a Turing machine. He has developed Turing machine. He taught the British Army how to decode the German machine and all. So that's a great thing. Alan Turing. Then Donald Knuth is one great gentleman. There's a lot. Listen, Alan Turing. He's a father of computer science. He invented the Turing machine in 1936 special paper. Our computer is basically an approximation of Turing machine. He has also invented how to decode the Nazi machine and avoid bombing at by German. So he's a great man. Unfortunately, he made suicide in 1954. There's a good, both cinemas are available. The Imitation Game, you must see, is available. There is another gentleman, Donald Knuth. And this is, I am basically telling about the data structure. C is only available, only these things are available. But whenever you're using the Python, these are the data structures are available there. When the data structures are more sophisticated, your program is less complicated. So your intelligence inputs in your data. And whenever your program is less, it is maintenance is easier, writing is easier. So that is the reason whenever anybody works on writing in Python, it is much shorter, maybe 10 times shorter, but it is also might be 10 times slower also. But right now the machines are so powerful, so we don't need this kinds of huge thing. Okay, so that is the use of data structure. You get lots of data structure there. There's other advantages also, that is C is, you have to compile it again and run it. And in this thing, our Python, the data Python data structure, it can be run on virtual machine. So like Java, so it creates a virtual machine of its own. So and any machine, then it runs on it. So that is the whole code is portable. C language, source language is portable, but you have to again compile it. So Python is an interpreted language like Java. And another thing is advantage of Python over Java is it is dynamically typed. Okay, so let's see to the next.
Sir.
Yeah, follow. Yes, tell me.
Sir, Python being interpreted would be slower than as compared to Java and
C++. Definitely. I have told number of times Python is slower, 3 to 4 times slower than Java. And maybe 10 times slower than C, but that is not issue because your machines are much more powerful. Your mobile phone right now have octa-core, even your laptop has also octa-core, so speed doesn't really matter. Okay, but if you think the speed means only the running time, that is not. Whenever you see speed, what is the development cost of a program? Development cost is, say, if you write a program in C, it will take 1 month, and if you write in Python, it may 1 day. So that is also come to speed. So how quickly you can develop it, because any program's lifetime is not typically maybe 1 month or maximum 1 year. The program has to be changed. So that is the thing, the speed doesn't matter, because here the Python coding is less, and a lot of things are additional modules are already developed in C++. Only you are binding it to Python. So you are not eliminating C. All the Python libraries our background, which are working on C++, but there is a wrapper around those libraries that is in Python. So Python is talking actually C++, so it is not at that time slower than C that much, but definitely slower, but that doesn't matter because Python is an easily developed. Okay, can we carry on? And I'll take all questions answer in the later. Okay, so that is the brute force technique. Brute force means finding a pin from a haystack. So you need a clever techniques like the magnet, that is called algorithm. This is brute force. That is a basically clever technique. So we had this. This is a brute force algorithm. Because why you know the brute force? Because you always the brute force is always there. Then you how will improve like divide and conquer, like Mars sort. I have told. Like there are various techniques like brute force, divide and conquer, decrease and conquer. That's different technique. Okay. So this is a constant algorithm. Every time you use a stack in our machine, like stack is like whenever you are making a function call, you call everything put into a stack. Like it is a stack is very much used. So stack is everything happens in the top of the stack. So anything happen push or pop or any operand is a push and pop. So that is a constant amount of time. So O1 logarithmic time is O log n. It's if you put your values in a binary search tree, then you can get it from the log n time. If you don't put it in a list, then you get O n time. Lesser number, because log n, remember, is the base of 2, because they divide and conquer. So either see if you hit a number whether on the right side of the binary search tree or left side of the binary search tree. So then if it is the right side, then you go to the middle, whether it's right side of it or left side. So it is a log n, it is coming. Linear, I have told you in my earlier videos that how to find a list is there or an array is there, how to find a maximum. So you have to go to it, everyone, and to find it. Okay, that's a linear. The complexities, lots of complexities are there. These two interesting problems, one 2 to the power n complexity. This is a Tower of Hanoi problem I have covered in my earlier videos. That is a brute force, and that is you cannot improve it because restriction there, 3 sticks are there. You have to put all the circles to one stick to another, and another is a buffer. So if number of disks is n, the number of states will be 2 to the power n minus 1. So that is a typical problem that is called exponential problem, because n goes to here. Till now n cube, the n4, these are simpler problems, but whenever n goes to the higher side, that's a typical problem. Another problem I have told you, the traveling salesman problem, that is if you have a 10 friends and if they are distributed over West Bengal, and if your one friend try to visit all friends place, and there are paths from every friend to every friend, from starting from any friend and visiting only one and one friends only one time and coming back again, what is the shortest path? That is called traveling salesman problem, and that is factorial n. Okay, so let's go. So these are all these data structures are available in Python. That is a great thing about this. Okay, now quickly goes to Python, how to run Python at your machine. Yeah, how to run Python in your machine? If everybody types your machine at Gmail and put your another window, you can do it right now. You put in another window and type it Google space colab. Write it. I am also doing it here. You write it Google colab and press enter. And in the first screen, Google colab.research.google.com. You just click. Okay, this is one Python window will come up, and there you can see welcome to Colab. You can go for a new title. Okay, because I have already done it once, so I'm not doing it here again. Okay, I'm already doing it here again. So this is the Python window. So what, and you can download a Python interpreter on your own. And what is a great thing, say, if you write the first sentence in Python, say I am writing here, the Python here, you write it, you just write it, print hello world, you can type it here. You might ask that there is other way of running Python, that is you can download Python 3.7 under Windows or Linux and you can run the Python there also. So, but I found it is easier in Google Colab. So, this is it, you can run Python here, it is done this. In Python, the command language, it is visible or should I make it bigger, please? Anyone, please?
No, sir, it is visible.
Thank you. This is a Python, the command is, this is one, this number sign. This is a command and there is no such multi-line command as such. If you have a multi-line command, you have to give. So, this is a comment, and another great thing is Python, it is almost like a, that is simple, like C, but if you have a Java, you have to, if you know, somebody know Java, then you have to write lot of codes, public, static, void, main, std.println, like lot of things code is, it is not there in this Python. It is just simple print hello. You don't have to include your standard io.h and all this, like in C, nothing. Say everything's there in Python. If you have a multiple line, the three triple quotes, is this three under three triple quotes, you can do the multiple line comment. Okay, everything. I said this Python, if you want to have which version you are working in, if in other Python you just do write Python minus minus version, but in Google Colab you have to put exclamation mark on it, the exclamation mark Python minus minus version. So it will give, I have right now worked Python 3.7, it's very popular. Okay, this is one interesting point in Python that you, everyone please listen it carefully. Say Python, it is a basically dynamically typed, because it is not statically typed. Because what is the difference between statically typed and dynamically typed? Statically typed, it is typical compiler based. So everything you have, whenever you are writing the program, you are determining I1 should be integer, I1 should be, F1 should be floating point number. Python, it is not. Whenever you initialize it, it determines at that time. And you can later put it on integer, put it on floating point number, it can be. So, here so I1, first initialize is 12, say integer. Then I write it, print type of I1, it will, which type. And then I write ID. This is interesting. What is ID? And print I1. Let's run this. Yeah. So, this is the first line is classing. That is, it is the inbuilt class integer. It is automatically sensed from the data. So that is great thing, because when you make a dynamical type, when you have programs, you are not sure where it is running, whether your, which server it is running. So this dynamically type is very, is a glue like thing, which is great advantage over Java and C and C++. That is the reason Python development type is much quicker. Okay. So it is a class, and then what is this number? This number will change from computer to computer. This is a basically indicative, a sort of pointer, it is not a pointer, it is a number where it is stored, but it is no significance for us. Okay, it is no significance for us. And if we write a I2, another number, and 12, and print T, and if you write the print ID of I2, it will same. So Python makes some, they isolate user to the, how they keep the data, that is their choice. So if you run the program, I'm just running this program. Put I1 there, I2 there, and here also see there, these values are same, though it is a different ID, but till the data is same, they put it in the same place. If we change it, say, and now I change this to I2 equal to 13, now we see the ID of I2 changes. Earlier it was I1 is 9088, now it was 9120. So that is one unique thing about Python which is not there in Java. So Python makes its own internal arrangement for keeping data. If the two integer datas are the same, they put it in the same box. That box number you can get it by print ID. That is no significance. If you change it I to any other number, that identification change. It is only for demonstration purpose, but that number is never used, at least whatever I have seen. So that's it. Then another interesting thing about the Python is it is very easy to, it is a, everything has to be indented. In C, it is not a mandatory, but here it is. Like here, the if 5 greater than 2, it will be true. So how the if language is, if 5 greater than 2, semi, this is a colon, and there should be always indentation, whether it could be 2 character, whether it's 4 character, whether 1 character, must be indentation. Without indentation, it will give an error. So that is, that means this is the body of if loop. So how to see the body of a if loop? Now it is the body of a if loop means it may not be necessary, but it should not be zero space. It should be either 1, 2, 3, anything, but that is. And if, see, let, this is the code, if 5 greater than 2, this is the if loop and print, and I, if I have a, another extra jump, no issue, it will type it. Okay. But that doesn't look nice. But that is a good programming. But if you say, I try it here, if I try it here, no indentation. Let's try. Yeah, it will be give error. So if I give one indentation, just see one indentation, whether it will run? It will run. Okay, so the indentation is a must, even if it's a one. But my choice is, I always recommend four characters or two characters. Four characters is good enough to visualize your program in loops. Okay, so this is it. Then another is, say here, x is initialized 4, print type of x, print x, and x sally. Then I later on I initialize with a sally and see it. Let's see what happens. So it will take it. I initialize it with 4, then it is an integer and then it is a string. No issue. First is initially classing and value is 4. This is a class string Sally. Okay. So that is what is, that is called dynamically typing. That is not available in Java, and that is the reason strength of Python. And Python is slower, I admit, but if you take the whole scope, development time and the debugging and the, then the Python is not at that slower than C and Java. Okay, but it's quicker, and a lot of other areas of programming like machine learning, where C cannot, Java cannot, then only Python can do. Machine learning, Python and another language is R is there. Okay. Now is a casting. So see here, if, so I want to forcefully string it, say x initially string, that is a casting it, string 3, then it will be a string 3, x integer y, this is automatically C, this is a class string, and this is a class integer, class 4. Okay, this is another, what I believe, I want to take your suggestion. So I'll make this, how you feel, should I continue? I can continue. How you feel, then I can, because already it's close 7 p.m. I'm fine for another 10-15 minutes. Please give your feedback, at least one or two feedback is enough in my WhatsApp group. WhatsApp group will give you feedback, otherwise it will be noise.
So attendance
in the, in your chat box, everybody write the chat box, that is where attendance. You put your questions here in your WhatsApp, then I can see it here.
Same
name, like that is the origin of Java also. It is, it has to be simple sign command image, that is it. That is the reason of Python. That's it. Okay. Okay, if you see G portable OP language, nobody can understand. It is like a proper name, your name. Somebody have, doesn't have to be name actually meaning to it. Okay, in Germany particularly, they don't have any meaning. They can be anything. They mean your garden and all these things. Okay, so let's continue with some more details. This is another part in Python. You can have a multiple assignment. Like here, I can multiple assignment X, Y, Z. I can orange, banana, cherry. So you can see it. Class, it is string. Orange, banana, cherry, it is coming. Then you have a unpack a list, like this is a list, fruits is a list. How do you signify the list? The third bracket open, third bracket in, that is a list. List is a different kind of array. It is not a typical array. Array in C, all type is same types, but list here is all a string, but it can have strings, integer, floating point number. So fruits is apple, banana, cherry, x, y, z is the fruit. Print x, automatically x will be apple, Y will be banana, C will be cherry. So all this in the, I am taking a it will be recorded to you and given it to you. Please see it. And the website also mentioned there. Here, X is awesome. This is one concept of X is awesome. Python, what is Python is awesome will be printed. Okay, that's great. And I also do like here. X is Python is Y is awesome. Then if I say two string by plus, then it will be automatically concatenated. But if we one side is a string, another side is a number, then Python will create exception. That means error. Exception means error. So here you see Python is awesome. But here, say x is 5, y is 10. Python will not say 5, 10. It will say 50. It will take the, it is intelligent enough that 5 is an integer, 10 is an integer, it will add. It is not concatenate. But like see here, x is 5, y is John, and if you say print x plus y, it will create an exception. Okay. So whenever both side match, plus means concatenation, if it is a number, it will add. So it is intelligent. It is called operator overloading in those who know about little bit of C++ and Java. That is a great thing of object-oriented programming. Now, see here, x I equal to 1 integer, y is a 2.8 float. This is a comment, you know. And type of jade, you see, this is one great thing. Python can have a complex number. This is typically C, Java doesn't have. See, the complex number is j. This is a complex number. J is root over minus 1 for information. So here, another m complex. F 3 plus 5j, y is equal to 5j minus j. See here. All are class complex. These are built-in. This is the advantage of Python again and again. These are built-in support is there. So complex number, because you know your differential equation calculation or any numerical equation, complex number is there. Convert from one type to another. It is also, you write this program and you just convert by casting. Like you write float, int, complex. It will automatically convert. It will be automatically concrete. This is another good concept, is create a variable inside a function and the same global variable. Like here, x is outside, this is a global variable. X is awesome. And this is the definition of, this is a typical function declaration. This is a, like in C, we have to name up the function. Here, it is def, keyword is def. This is the function declaration, my function, colon. This is the declaration of the function, this is the body of the function. So I change it here, x is fantastic, print Python is plus x, and my function I call it here. Actual program starts here, my function, then I call it here. You just type it. Why it is coming, I will tell, explain. First is Python is fantastic. Why the Python is fantastic? It is, whenever you call it here, it is here, it is fine that Python is fantastic. It print out Python is fantastic. But right now, whenever it comes out of this, it go print Python is x, then x is outside awesome, not fantastic. Fantastic, I have changed it here. So it is come Python is awesome. Okay. That is the concept of global variable. Whenever put it there and outside of a function, that is a global. You don't have to say global. That is a global variable. And inside you have a same variable. You override it with a different. Then that will be that values. And whenever you outside that function, it will take the value of global variable. Same is here. If you say here, but here I can put the function that variable name inside and say global x. That means it is same as put x is here. So you can put it here in the keyword global, then it will be global. Yeah. See, Python global x, x is fantastic, my function, Python is fantastic. Okay. So because now I declare x is global, then it is a global. Okay. So
Sir, we cannot change the values of the global variable.
Yes, always. You can always change the value of global variable, but that will be only visible whenever within the inside function. Whenever you outside the function, whatever the effect of the earlier there, it will be there. So, global variable concept is yes.
What is def?
Definition of function. That is a...
Like we always have to write that.
Yes. Whenever in C, whenever you declare a function, you have to give the function name, okay, the parameters inside it. The same as a Java. Yeah. Java is also, you have a function named parameters. Here,
why?
Yeah, please listen. You are, please listen. Try to understand and go to books. This, I am clearing it. So, this is the definition of a function. Def. This is a keyword. Now, what is the function? Because all, why the programs is there? Nobody writes 100 lines of program. Always objective is program should be 10 lines. Any repetitive things, we put in a function and call that function again and again. Then the, your 100 lines of program can be within, say, 20 lines. So, that is the basic objective of what? Computer science programming. We can solve any problem with 100 line, 1000 line program where without no function call. That program will run faster, but that program will take much huge amount of time in main memory. That is maybe in slower. So, every time what is we try to have? The any large operations, we try to chunk it, divide it and repeatable operation. That we call function and then we call the function. So, same thing in Python, whenever you declare a function, you call that function again and again. Whenever you have a new function, we declare it by def, the function name and colon. And the body of the function should be one indentation left. One means it can be four characters. I prefer four characters. This is the body of the function. Then you call the function. So, your actual operation begins here, not here. This is the definition of function. Def, my function, this. Okay, let's continue. Then at the end, we can ask all the questions.